I'm now delighted to introduce our first panel on enhancing education accessibility on a shared island. Our first panellist is Professor Ian Greer, who's been President and Vice-Chancellor of Queen's University Belfast since August 2018. A medical graduate of the University of Glasgow, he has extensive experience of university innovation driving regional economic growth, including cross-sector developments such as the Northern Health Science Alliance, a collaboration of 8 universities and NHS partners. And he's also the co-founder of the Health Innovation Research Alliance for Northern Ireland.
It's good to be joining you for this important discussion. And to start off with, I'd like to touch on one or two areas that are important to us at Queen's University. The first of these is access to university and widening participation. We actively monitor the widening participation profile of our students. This year, 31% of accepted applicants, that's around 1,100 students, came from the most deprived socioeconomic quintiles. We've also had an annual increase in the number of care experience students coming to Queen's, and we support them with care leaver bursaries. One particular programme I wanted to mention was the Pathway Opportunity Programme. It's now entering its 5th year and it continues to surpass the original targets. What it does is it offers students support in the last year of school to help them access university, gives them a taste of university life before they start, discounts their entry grades, and despite that, the degree outcome is similar to other cohorts. And we also give them a £1,000 per annum bursary, which we raise from philanthropy. For 21-22, some 150 students were accepted through the pathway scheme. That includes, for the first time, 5 medical students and 2 dentistry students. I'd also say that not all these students come to Queen's. 52 of the students were accepted onto courses at other institutions, which we also see as a success. Now, in a forum like this, it's also important to consider mobility across the island of Ireland. And we know that north-south mobility figures are low, and usually east-west mobility is substantially higher. And that's despite the fact that there are many opportunities in universities across the island that would be advantageous to our students. And so we should think about enhancing mobility within courses across all our universities. Such mobility will build ties and allow the students the experience of other cultures and appreciate the diversity across the island. And of course, it will support good relations between these cultures. But it's not just the cultural issues that we can address through student mobility. We can also exchange ideas between the people of Ireland and Northern Ireland, and that can drive research and innovation projects, which can propel the island of Ireland towards the kind of knowledge economy and society that we all aspire to. In Northern Ireland, we've started working across higher education and further education to link up the opportunities in a more systematic way, from foundation courses to course articulation. This can enhance student mobility and indeed widening participation. It's already happening in a small way across some courses and institutions, both in Northern Ireland and across the border. But it could be more systematic so that our tertiary education maximises the opportunities for our young people and for the economy. Finally, I think it's important to note that we need close links to business and industry. This helps us in the university sector understand the skills needs and involvement of business and industry with university delivery is really important. This is important in terms of employability, and we're very proud that in the Sunday Times Good University Guide, Queen's was ranked joint 11th in the UK for graduate prospects. We do that by working closely with employers, both in skills and also in innovation for business and industry problems. So through these skills and innovation initiatives, we can drive true economic impact. And I believe there are some exciting times ahead for collaboration across the island.
Thank you, Professor Greer. We also have Paul Hannigan, who's been president of Letterkenny Institute of Technology since January 1998. A business graduate of UCD, he's a former member of the Higher Education Authority and a deputy director of the Central Applications Office. He currently serves on the Donegal Local Community Development Committee and the Northwest Regional Executive of IBEC.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Paul Hannigan, president of Letterkenny Institute of Technology. I just want to thank you for the invitation to be here this morning to discuss this topic. From my perspective, I was born in County Donegal, Ballyshannon, County Donegal. I worked for 10 years in Dundalk Institute of Technology. And for the last 24 years, I've been president of Letterkenny IT. During that time, obviously, the board has played a part in my personal and professional life, and I'm always want to make a difference in terms of cross-border collaboration. I moved to Letterkenny in January 1998, which was a couple of months just ahead of the signing of the Good Friday Agreement. And we look forward to changes occurring on an ongoing basis in cross-border engagement at that time. One of the things we looked specifically at, and which is part of the discussion this morning, is looking at the movement of students both north and south and the accessibility of higher ed, further education for participants in that space. It's something that's always been part and parcel of what we've tried to do, but despite our best efforts, there's always been an issue about attracting students from Northern Ireland into the Republic of Ireland, with the exception of one or two institutions. And specifically, it's been an issue for the Institutes of Technology in terms of trying to attract students from Northern Ireland into the Republic. Things have changed over the last number of years where there has been some more flexibility and some more movement, but there are issues that need to be addressed. In the Northwest here, we have set up what we call a tertiary education cluster, which includes ourselves, Ulster University, Northwest Regional College and Donegal Education and Training Board. The main focus of that cluster is to look at mobility of students right across the board in terms of access initially through further education initiatives and how they can then proceed on to higher education from the further education colleges, whether it be to Ulster University or ourselves here in Letterkenny IT. That mobility is starting to move really well at the moment in terms of us offering advanced degrees for foundation degree holders in Derry City and also vice versa. So we've seen already great examples of people moving, taking advantage of four institutions and the cluster that's been established. And we see greater opportunities for the future for this level of accessibility and how we try and address that. The main reason we're coming together is to make life different for the people who live here in the region. Two local authorities have established the Northwest City region, including Letterkenny, Derry and Strabane. And the fact that the political system has come together to create this space means that the education partners have a place to play in. We have a recognised Northwest City region now, recognised by all stakeholders, recognised by the National Development Plan, and creating opportunities for us to come together in a more coordinated manner than we may have done previously. So in terms of the issue of access to education, in terms of creating opportunities for students here in the region, we feel there's real potential in this, and that it's been backed by the Higher Education Authority on the basis of the proposals that we have put to them. So we look forward as we continue our journey to learn from our experiences to date, to impart that knowledge to others who can maybe benefit from it, but ultimately to improve the situation here in this region for school leavers, for those who wish to return to education, and for those who have traditionally come across barriers or perceived barriers to education in the past. We feel that the work of the cluster will be really informative for developments elsewhere. And as someone, as I said at the beginning, has been involved in working on the border for a number of years, we see this as a real opportunity to develop a new way of work. So I look forward to the discussion later on this morning. Look forward to listening to people's perceptions on this and how we can improve the overall situation for cross-border activity. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul Hannigan. Our last panellist for this discussion is Clare Austick, President of the Union of Students in Ireland and former USI Vice President for Welfare. She also held the positions of President, Vice President for Welfare and Equality and part-time Equality Officer of NUI Galway Students Union. She's from Galway and studied science, specialising in chemistry. She's passionate about breaking down the barriers to accessing third level education, about student wellbeing, positive body image, social justice and equality issues, and promoting consent education.
Ahoyja, my name is Clare Austick and I am the President of the Union of Students in Ireland. I'm very grateful to be a panellist in today's discussion with the Shared Island Dialogue Series on the topic of enhancing education accessibility on a shared island. The Union of Students in Ireland represents over 374,000 students across the island of Ireland. Our core mission has always been to protect access to third level education and break down any barriers that exist. Our student demographic is very vast and unique, with students from all different kinds of backgrounds studying all around the country, from Galway to Dublin and from Cork to Donegal. They represent students in the Republic of Ireland and students in Northern Ireland. One very clear observation, which is quite surprising, is that there are very few students from the south studying in the north and vice versa. This is why I think the conversation today is so timely and needed. The Shared Island Dialogue Series has enormous potential and opportunity to really be a driver in starting the conversation and process around enhancing education accessibility, cross-border mobility, partnership and cooperation between higher education institutions across the island. Integral to this conversation is the belief that education is a right and should never be seen or treated as a privilege. Unfortunately, there are many students who cannot access third level education in Ireland today due to the structural barriers that are in place. The most significant barrier being the student contribution charge of 3,000 in the Republic of Ireland and the tuition fees of 4,000 in Northern Ireland. The search for student accommodation over the last decade has also become more challenging year on year as student numbers have increased, but the building of affordable purpose-built student accommodation has not. Many students are often choosing courses close to their family homes that are easy to commute from rather than the course of their dreams due to the accommodation shortage. It cannot go without saying that the student contribution charge, coupled with the cost of accommodation and cost of living, remains the largest barrier in accessing third level education. When we talk about access to education, we must also think about the journey of progression to education. It isn't just about getting students through the door, it's about facilitating students to continue through their journey by reaching their full potential, by having equal opportunities to engage in, and by having the best, most meaningful college experience possible and having access to essential support services. We're now heading into a very exciting era with the creation of technological universities, but we must also think ahead and consider the geographical challenges that are brought with them. And we need to ensure that students have access to, you know, transport routes and ensure that they have access to all the different campuses equally. Some thoughts I would love to explore in today's discussion to enhance education accessibility around awareness of studying in the Republic of Ireland and in Northern Ireland, ensuring that at leaving cert level, students are able to look at the different options available to them across the island. We need to ensure that students engaging in clubs and societies are able to meet students all across the country. We could explore looking at studying in different parts of the country for a semester at a time. We also need to ensure that new initiatives and programs and supports that are introduced are inclusive of the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland as well. The Shared Island initiative has huge potential and enormous opportunity for future generations to come, and I really, really look forward to engaging in the rest of the discussion today. Gurmila Mahugat.
Thank you, Claire. So we have some time now to discuss, you know, enhancing the education accessibility on a shared island. From listening to your videos, it seems to me that it's broken into almost two sections. First of all, that access to, you know, further and higher education is one point, and then the mobility across the island as a second point. But Professor Greer, I want to ask you first about that accessibility program that you have in Queen's and how successful it's been in broadening the diversity of the student cohort. You know, you told us that the degree outcome is similar. These are the most able but the least likely students to continue. It sounds like a wonderful scheme. Is it something that you think could be expanded, that could extend to other institutions, both North and South?
Yes, I do. I don't think there's anything unique about the scheme. It's the type of scheme that any university or college could employ. The important factors are that we pick up or identify potential students during their secondary education, and we give them the right support to make Queen's seem accessible and to actually be accessible to them. And despite discounting their grades for entry, they do remarkably well, and it's good to support them through their whole journey. So picking them up towards the end of their secondary school education, all the way through to they graduate and start to move into the employment market, I think is really important. And we've got many strong advocates arising from that programme already. So in short, yes, we could see a similar programme across other institutions who can adapt it to their own needs of their institution and their community.
I'm really struck by it because I think, you know, it obviously takes leadership to follow a pathway like this through, particularly when you're looking for philanthropic funding for it. Is it something that you think could or should be funded by governments when they are focusing on increasing accessibility to further and higher education?
Well, we should certainly look at all funding options. And funding is an issue for higher education because we do want to be competitive globally and make sure that the students who come to university on this island get the very best. And I can assure you that the talent that we've got on the academic side is incredibly strong. You can get a world-class education on this island. You don't have to leave. And you can do almost any course across the island, which is terrific. Funding is obviously very tight, but we want to use it wisely. And we've certainly not encountered great difficulty in raising significant funds philanthropically to support this initiative. Many, many people feel strongly about access to education and making sure that we do deliver initiatives like this. So philanthropy can be very successful. I've certainly made it a priority for me since I came to Queen's to drive this forward, and it's really heartening to see the response and the impact. And it can reach anyone because we've got lots of disadvantaged communities on this island. You know, last night I was at a school where I was hearing about some of the issues with refugees and asylum seekers from other countries, and they're also challenged. And we have to adapt our systems and processes of support to be inclusive and take people like that into our system also.
Thank you. It sounds like a wonderful model that we probably should share more information on. Claire, coming to you, and it kind of leads on from that discussion, because as you've mentioned yourself, for a lot of students, you know, the tuition fees, the accommodation, the transport, the cultural barriers, childcare for many students, these are all, you know, huge issues. I suppose if you managed to consider all the options that are available to you across the island, do you think some of those difficulties, some of those challenges could be reduced even just by widening our knowledge of what options are available to us as students who want to progress?
Yeah, absolutely. And I do think it comes down to that awareness and educational piece. You know, when students are in either their leaving cert or doing their A-levels, that they're able to explore the different options available to them. Very often in the South, you know, guidance counsellors will only provide suggestions on the different higher education institutions that are available in the South, and similarly in Northern Ireland as well. So exploring all different options with students and giving them the choice for them to decide what course is best for them. So there are definitely significant challenges and barriers in the way in terms of access to education, both North and South. And this comes down to the cost of education and the wider cost of education when we talk about accommodation, the fees, the student contribution charge, the tuition fees, the hidden costs, cost of living, material fees and transport as well, when students want to commute back home to their family homes if they're studying in Northern Ireland and travelling back down to the South. So these are all huge challenges that I suppose can be tackled if there was more funding invested into the sector as a whole, if it reduced the tuition fees for students to avail of. And I think Ian made a really great point in terms of the outreach programmes and the targeted initiatives to try and get people to see the different avenues that are available to them. So while there are barriers in place, we can certainly try and tackle them and make sure that students, wherever they are, can study in any place and any course that they want to and that's right and best for them.
Thanks, Claire. And yeah, we can try and talk about the solutions now that we've highlighted all the issues that are there. And coming to you, Paul, on that, you seem to have built a solution in your region with that cooperation that you have between other institutes regionally to you across the border, that, you know, you're taking students from other places that they continue their education in Letterkenny. Before talking about that and potentially, you know, that programme being expanded, can you tell me about the students that come to Letterkenny initially? And because often for students, it's actually just coming in through the door and realising, well, this is a place that I can go. This is a place I can belong to.
Yeah, I think generally, around 50% of the school leavers within County Donegal who go on to higher education actually come to Letterkenny IT. So we get really strong support from the local region. Overall, we take about 30-35% of our student population from elsewhere right around the country. And so there is a fair mix in terms of student body here in Letterkenny. I think in the context of the access issue, I think we have looked at this over the last 20 years. We've had an access office in operation here, which we call the Curve. And really we're looking at ways of dealing with the issues that have been raised by Claire and Ian in terms of attracting students back on campus. For some people, if they may have had very negative experiences of education previously, so it might be just breaking down those barriers in terms of getting them physically across the threshold of the building, and to take away the fear that they may have, that's mostly for mature students returning. So in that, from that perspective, that's a real issue that we need to deal with. But it has worked over the years. There has been great activity from our perspective in terms of smoothing the path for those students back in. Also students from disadvantaged backgrounds. I think the institutes of technology generally right across the country and the emerging technological universities have always been access colleges, have always looked at opening up pathways for students to come through. And that would be reflected in the socioeconomic profile of the various student populations right across the country. So, you know, it's an active agenda from our perspective. It always has been. And the success rate for students coming through in terms of their progression right through programmes, their graduation rates and their employment rates subsequently really has pushed towards that being a really very successful approach.
Thanks, Paul. We've got a contribution from the floor now, and there are questions coming in already, and I want to remind people to keep going with that, with the chat function. But I do think it's important to recognise that the Institutes of Technology and soon to be the technological universities are doing a great job in welcoming students from all backgrounds to campus. But we have a question in from Maria Joyce, which I'll come to after our contribution from Professor Jerry McKenna, who is Senior Vice President at the Royal Irish Academy and Chair of the Royal Irish Academy Higher Education Futures Group. He's going to ask a question to the panel, but I just perhaps we'll give a little bit of background on the RIA, because that is an all-Ireland institution, and perhaps that's something we should be focusing more on, the all-Ireland groups that are involved in education. So, Jerry, we'll take your contribution, please.
Very much. And can I just say that all of the comments by the speakers on improving all-Ireland collaboration, removing barriers, and improving access and mobility are highly commendable and hugely impressive. And these efforts deserve our thanks and our coordinated support. And just to chime what you said, much of what you said ties in with the forthcoming reports emanating from the Royal Irish Academy's Higher Education Futures Task Force, which will be reporting shortly, as the Minister said. But if I could make a comment, it is a recognised reality across the world that citizens living in border areas tend to be disadvantaged socially and economically. And this includes limitations in tertiary education provision. And notwithstanding the heroic efforts, which we've heard about earlier, of individual institutions and the support of local government and the private and the third sectors, the levels of shared tertiary education provision along the Ireland-Northern Ireland border, and I'm talking about from Louth to Donegal and from down to Derry, Londonderry, along the entirety of the border, are less than ideal. Sustained peace, stability, and prosperity are dependent upon regions and communities not being left behind. Would the panel like to comment on how initiatives like Peace Plus, the Shared Island Funds, and other funds, including, for example, the UK Levelling Up Funds, might be utilised to promote cross-border initiatives in tertiary education, including further education along the border regions, helping to remove or reduce the negative consequences of geographic and political peripherality.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jerry. And perhaps, Ian, would you like to take this about how the initiatives that are already there can be harnessed to really help students on those in those border regions access education to them?
Well, I think it's important that we have events such as this, which actually make people aware of the initiatives that we have. All too often, people are unaware. I'm sure we can share knowledge and resources about the different schemes that we have available. I think it's really important that we get the whole tertiary education system working together so that the young people have access to the right course, the right choice for them. There's a fantastic array of choices across the island, and it's really important that they don't feel that they have to make a decision, say at 17 or 18, that locks them into one particular course. So I think that we need to think about how we make sure that the students know that they've got a wide choice, that there are ways to support them. If it may, on the surface, feel that they can't do something, we can usually find a way to get able students through particular courses. I also think it's important for them to be able to switch between courses or organisations as their studies progress. If they do want to change their destination, why can't they change the institution that they're studying in or transfer temporarily, which also is great for an exposure to a different culture. And with that in mind, I think it's also important to raise the issue of flexible education. With the COVID pandemic, we've seen all of our institutions have had to adapt to how we deliver education, which in some ways has made it more accessible too. And I think the future is about more flexibility in education, not just where you study or how you study, but when you study and for how long. I think we'll see more part-time delivery, and I think we'll see more blended delivery between online and in-person teaching. When you put all that together, increasing knowledge of what's available, better support, more flexibility, I think we can really have a unique world-class offer for our students, no matter where they are in the island.
Thanks, Ian. And Paul, I'm going to come back to you with that question from Jerry, but I just want to go to Claire on that point. First of all, Claire, do you think there's an appetite from students at the moment to have that type of part-time, the type of blended education that, Ian is speaking about, where it might be a little bit more flexible to switch between modules or terms across institutions across the island?
Absolutely. And I think some really great points are made. So I think one of the positives from COVID actually was the online and hybrid learning. So being able to provide spaces for students to learn in their own time and their own homes. For many students who are either carers or have children who have other responsibilities, and sometimes lectures from Monday to Friday isn't always ideal. So definitely trying to accommodate students where they're at and have to support them as best as they can. And with that comes recognition that there's different types of learners, and trying to facilitate the different learning spaces to ensure that everyone can reach their full potential and engage in the best, most effective way. I think one of the points as well in terms of how we our mindset towards education and accessing education, it's not just about enrollment, it's about accessing different supports, it's about progression, it's about transitioning, and it's about being able to access education at any stage in your life as well. So if a student at 17 decides to do a course that they then realise they don't really like, that they then can go back in 10 years' time and upskill or reskill or change your mind and do another course degree. But as a result of the financial barriers that are in place, many people can't do that. So I think it's about even shaping that mindset and that attitude and changing the culture that we currently have and kind of seeing education as lifelong learning. It's not just about a four-year degree or a master's on top of that. So there definitely is a need and a desire to make education more accommodating and more flexible. And I think COVID has definitely facilitated those initial conversations to see what structures can be implemented to carry on in a really positive way.
I think that's really interesting. And it is probably something we all need to consider, that your education, your further education, it doesn't need to be one continuous linear progression, that actually taking gaps might be a good idea. And looking at options in other areas might be also helpful for your own education. Paul, just jumping back on Professor McKenna's question, how can we utilize the funds that are there to help remove or reduce the negative consequences of geographical and political peripherality along the border? Something you're obviously very familiar with in your own institution and because of where it's situated.
Yeah, thanks very much, Eveen. And I've had a lot of discussions with Jerry on this topic previously. I think from our perspective, as I said in the presentation at the beginning, setting up the cross-border cluster, which is a tertiary education cluster, including Donegal ETB, Northwest Regional College, ourselves and the University of Ulster, has recognised the issues that Jerry has raised and the issues that we're trying to address as a result of that. If we go back to the launch of that initiative a few years back, one of the students who spoke at that launch was somebody who had started off working as a milkman, then went into Northwest Regional College, started to do an introductory program there, moved to Letterkenny IT to proceed to a degree, and is now completing a PhD with us, and has just some papers published already this week. We also have a situation where for the first time in over 30 years, ourselves, with the help of Donegal ETB, have gone back into the provision of electrical craft apprenticeships on campus here in Letterkenny this week. Also, Northwest Regional College has significant investment in that area and in skills development in Derry. And Ulster University have just opened a new medical school in the city in Derry as well. So you're looking at, the broad range of activity that's happening across those four institutions. But if we're not attracting the people from the local region into that space, then we're failing and we're not addressing the issue that Jerry has pointed out. But if you look at the statistics, and I'm just looking particularly at Donegal now at the moment, the completion rate to leaving cert in County Donegal in the mid-90s was around 75%. The 75% of the cohort who could complete their leaving cert did at the time. That has jumped hugely into the 90%, so one of the highest in the country now at the moment, because the people of the region recognize the power of education and the opportunities that it creates for them. So you have huge completion to leaving cert now at the moment in the region. You also have really significant movement into further and higher education following that, where the participation rates have increased significantly. And that's taken into consideration the barriers that have already been mentioned by Claire, and people are finding ways of dealing with that and how they manage it themselves. But really, it's a really strong commitment that people have recognised that education further in higher education is the passport into a new life in terms of what people want to achieve. They're pushing towards that. They're doing everything they can to achieve it. And we, as the institutions that are involved in the provision in that space, have a moral responsibility to make sure that people can avail of those opportunities. So I think going back to Jerry's point, that I think it's really important that it's been raised through the RIA and on an all-island basis. You know, I'm very conscious of what we're doing here in this border region. I'm very conscious that that can be transferred to other parts of the region. But we're not doing it for ourselves. We're doing it for the people who live here and creating the opportunities for them to progress further.
Thank you, Paul. We've got a couple of questions now from our audience. And I'm going to go, first of all, to Maria Joyce, who's from the National Traveller Women's Forum. Maria, thank you for your question.
Thank you for bringing me in. And I just wanted to particularly ask a question just in terms of what the institutions see as the next steps in increasing and deepening the participation of travellers in third level, both in accessing them and in, you know, supporting them through it. And it's really interesting just to listen to some of the solutions that are being identified in relation to some of the issues that have come up this morning. And I suppose in the context of travellers, I suppose in terms of some of your responses, just looking at what, you know, in terms of some of those solutions, in terms of increasing targets, both in terms of travellers within their institutions, in terms of sort of strategic plans and programmes, more targeted supports and special measures. And a number of grant schemes were mentioned this morning in the Minister's opening. And I'm just wondering, are there specific ring fencing within those resources for groups who are underrepresented in third level institutions, and travellers being one of those groups? And I suppose it was interesting in terms of listening to some of the discussion around, you know, the campus and how that, and that's a space that supports students through. And I'm just in terms of sort of looking at then campuses that welcome traveller undergraduates and follow through in terms of the employment. In terms of travellers' experience in employment, it, you know, they're experiencing significant racism and access and opportunities around employment. And even travellers who have gone to third level find it difficult and challenging. And the last point I want to make, just in terms of possibly some of those solutions, was some of the discussion around flexibility and the part-time options. And I suppose that's particularly relevant in terms of traveller women who are going back in as mature students, and the importance of institutions engaging with and recognising the different phases. Mm-hmm. We have a very diverse community, and the different phases some ethnic minorities may engage in third level. And I'm going to leave it there, I suppose. If I just want to toss out some of the kind of what possible solutions are around some of the issues in terms of the act.
That's great. Thank you very much, Maria. And definitely something that we really need to highlight is the underrepresentation of certain groups, and specifically traveller groups. Ian, coming to you, or sorry, actually Paul, coming to you first. Is this something that you have targeted programmes for in Letterkenny, and are you aware of other programmes in other ITs or soon to be now the TUs that are there specifically to address those underrepresented groups like travellers and traveller women who would like to come back to education?
Yeah, it falls under our general access programmes that I've already spoken about this morning evening. We have had examples of travellers coming through in various different programmes and graduating here from Letterkenny IT and holding down very strong positions in terms of their community, in terms of representative groups here in Donegal. But we haven't enough. And, you know, it is an issue that we need to address, and it's something that needs to be addressed. We can see over the last number of years, the diversity of our student population has changed remarkably in terms of, you know, firstly in terms of mature students, but then in terms of the ethnic diversity of the group that's there, also international students coming from abroad. So we end up with a very broad mix and a very diverse student population, which is really, really important in terms of the development of the institution. And that's replicated right across the sector. Some institutes may have more targeted specific programs for travelers in specific parts of the country. I'm not exactly sure, but I know that all of them in one way or another deal with this issue under their general access programs. And it's something that we're very aware of and something that we will continue to work towards.
Thanks, Paul. Claire, I want to come to you just on that question briefly, if you don't mind. In the USI, do you have specific programs, specific targets for having those underrepresented communities, specifically traveller communities, the traveller community represented within the USI and within the various institutions across the island.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think this was a brilliant question as well, with many great comments. So in terms of the, we wouldn't necessarily have an outreach program in terms of getting, those from ethnic minorities into education. But what we do run are different training events to try and get more representation of those who are from a traveling background or in ethnic minority communities to put themselves forward for leadership positions or being put themselves forward to try and get different, initiatives and ideas. I suppose, implemented into their local campuses. So I think there's a reference made to it in the National Access Plan as well, going forward, and that's kind of specific to higher education institutions. But from a USI perspective, we run different campaigns and, outreach programs, and then we have our Empower event that specifically encourages and empowers those from ethnic minorities to put themselves forward, to take a leadership position, to put themselves forward, on their students' union committees on colleges in colleges as well, so that's something that we're focusing on to try and make sure that the voices of those who are impacted by different issues and all that are heard as well in their local campus communities.
Thanks, Claire. I'm going to take another question now. This is from Dermot O'Callaghan in TU Dublin. Dermot, if you're ready.
Thanks, Aileen. I'm picking up a sense of a common thread coming through what Claire started with, and then Ian picked up, and then Maria has just mentioned it there now, is around students' needs and expectations around flexibility of how they experience higher education. And just to suggest that with a small bit of organisation, we could create common curriculum programmes across the entire island that would allow students to choose regular daytime experience, evening experience, or indeed online experience throughout their journey as their needs, their personal and social needs change throughout their journey. It is a model that would be somewhat similar to the underpinning spirit of the European University of Technology concept. So just to put that out there, that would be within our gift to offer flexibility to students across the entire island. And we have learned so much in the COVID experience that we could do that relatively quickly if a group put their mind to it.
Thank you, Dermot. A silver lining to the pandemic and the provision of education. Ian, this is interestingly something that we actually spoke about in our conversation before the panel, that you had this idea that the common curriculum is something that we could actually establish across the island and perhaps have an Erasmus-style programme where you could easily move between institutions across the island as well.
Absolutely. And we don't even have to physically move now. We can virtually move and experience different parts of our great tertiary education system on the island. So I would certainly support that type of approach. You could imagine that we might do it for something where there's a shared need, a shared desire. For example, in our new strategy, like many universities, we've made sure that sustainable development issues like climate change are at the very core of what we do. And the students really want to understand these issues, which can be very challenging. Now, we could, for example, provide a module delivered online across every institution on this island that would give every student the ability to understand some of the key issues in sustainability, for example. It's also important when we're picking up the flexibility piece, and I think this was picked up with some of the earlier comments, that we don't forget people coming back into education, in particularly tertiary education. And during the pandemic, we saw a large number of people very rapidly lose their jobs or become furloughed. And of course, we're seeing a change, a transition in this island towards a knowledge economy. So we rapidly put in place some relatively short postgraduate certificate courses that would reskill people very rapidly with support from our Department for the Economy here in the North, that would reskill people to move into another sector. So I think that flexible approach, that ability to transition into a new sector later in life as the economy changes, as well as the ability to share resources across the island, could give a very compelling offer to people and to the economy.
Well, we seem to have the right people in the room, so perhaps you can continue this conversation maybe through the RIA with Dermot and Paul and Claire on having that common curriculum, that flexibility, and considering all the people who might actually benefit from having those different types of engagement in higher and further education. There are loads more questions coming in, but unfortunately our time has run out for this panel, but I imagine we can actually continue this thread and those themes for our next discussions. But I'd like to now thank Professor Ian Greer, Paul Hannigan and Clare Austick for your time and your contributions this morning, and also to our two discussants who joined us, Maria and Dermot.